Hello, I'm Alan.
And I'm Barry.
And we're going on a fantastic creative
and historical tour of the UK.
And I'm going to whip up all the fantastic juices that you've got inside you. You're going to find out what you can do, because everybody is creative. And we're going to go the length and breadth of the UK, discovering lots of people who are creative, and show you lots of creative things to do.
And we're going to knit together, nay, crochet together, the historical links between the UK and the USA. But first, we need some transport.
Transport? Brilliant. I wonder what it's going to get. It could be a... It's here. I wonder what it's going to be. What the heck's that?
Come on, get in.
Oh, God, you've not got that, have you?
Yeah, it's Brill.
Oh, God, we're supposed to be going all the way around the country. I'm supposed to have a bit of comfort. Am I supposed to get into this thing?
What's your problem? It's brilliant.
It's
an antique.
Antique? Look at the state of it.
It's got class.
What
it's got style. It's got character.
It looks like a deck chair.
No, it doesn't. It's an antique, as I said.
It's not an antique.
It is.
And everybody else has got sidecars.
It's got great suspension. What's your problem? It's fantastic.
Come on. What about something like a really flash car, a Cadillac? We've got like a bit of an American influence here.
No. You want something with character.
Well, I'm not going to get in that, am I?
Well, I think you will.
How's you get in?
We'll try the front door.
What was that?
Just ease yourself into it.
How can you ease yourself into this? God, I'm not going to get in this thing.
Get in, it's ever so easy.
Oh!
To you too.
Oh, God. Be gentle with me. Was that Alan? Yes.
Oh!
Are you in? I think I should get in there.
Really? How are you going to get in? Honestly, I feel like a sardine.
Hello, Betty.
Hello, Barry.
Alan, let me introduce you to this lovely lady.
Hello, Alan.
Lovely to meet you, Betty.
Oh!
I've told Betty all about the trip and she's so looking forward to it.
Well, we'd better get on our way then, aren't we?
So we're going off to Boston.
Oh, fantastic. Do you know where we're going, Betty?
Right, straight on. We're off, we're off, we're off in a motor car. 60 coppers are after us and we don't know where we are. Woo! Next right and left.
Is your sat-nav working?
Oh, leave her alone. Just let her sort herself out.
I bet she's not even found the satellite.
Now we want the second ride off the roundabout.
Don't you know where you're going, Betty?
Oh, turn around.
That's so clever, isn't she?
Told you, leave her alone.
And let's go all the way around the roundabout again. Just for fun.
Which exit is it, Betty? Left or right? Betty, we've been round this roundabout half a dozen times.
And left?
Oh, finally, we're on the road to Boston, are we?
Now, boys, we're off to Scotia's Quay.
What's there?
Now, this is where the Pilgrim Fathers were arrested.
Oh. Round 'em, cowboy! Woo-hoo! Giddy up.
Alan, will you behave yourself?
I'm enjoying myself.
Oh, nearly there. Oh, I can do it. Oh, I've not lost my touch. Breathe in, Alan. Oh, Alan. A bit too much breakfast this morning, I think. Alan, are you still on that diet?
I'm in the middle of the Lincolnshire countryside. In fact, I'm at Scotia's Creek, which is right behind me. And this is near Boston. The significance of this is where the Pilgrim Fathers attempted to leave here in 1607. And this memorial was erected in their memory in 1957. And back in 1607, William Brewster hired a Dutch ship to take him and the other group to Holland. Now, the reason why they wanted to leave is because they were different from the norm and they were being somewhat persecuted. But it was illegal for dissenters to leave this country. Unfortunately, the Dutch captain turned them into the authorities, and from there, they were taken to the Guildhall.
Built in 1390 and a Grade 1 listed building, the Guildhall has been in constant use since its construction. After the dissolution of the guilds, it was used as a town hall, courtroom, jail, and museum.
Allegedly, this is one of the cells in which the Pilgrim Fathers were held. Now, these cells are really quite tiny. In fact, I'd say that they're roughly about 8 feet long by about 6 feet wide. So you really do have to be friends with who you're sharing this with.
As part of the project, the historic sink and ovens in the Guildhall kitchens have been carefully restored by expert stone conservators. The brickwork throughout the building has been repaired using traditional materials and methods.
So when they're ready to go into the court, they're taken out of the cells and up these stairs. Not very good for those with a fuller figure. I think we'll have to look and see if there's any others.
Alan, have a look around, but don't get into any mischief. Oh! This narrow winding staircase to the courtroom must have produced a sense of foreboding in the accused. It certainly produced one in me.
Oh, oh. Now, Alan didn't make it up the stairs, but I did. Well, only just. Now, we're in the courtroom. I'm not doing that again.
William Brewster and several others were jailed for a short time. He was released and successfully emigrated to Holland in 1608, emigrating some years after to the United States. I feel like we've forgotten something. Born through a party in the
county jail. The prison. Is anybody gonna let me out? The band was jumping and the jump began to swing. You should have heard it knocked out. Thanks for waiting for me.
Do you know, I rather fancy a spot of afternoon tea now. Boys! Boys!
Oh, yeah.
Could you just get me half a litre of oil?
What, the best?
Yes, the premier grade. Ooh, and half a pint of screen wash. Oh, yeah, and I love an English muffin.
It's nice, isn't it?
It's lovely.
Hey, they've got food. They've got lots of like homemade food there as well. What do you fancy?
What have they got?
Oh, don't know, hang on. They've got a selection of homemade cheeses. They've got a weekend brunch. What day is it?
Tuesday.
Oh dear, okay. They've got cakes, they've got treacle tarts, they've got chocolate cherry cake.
That's the one.
They've got fruit cake. Hang on, I'm not finished. They've got lemon drizzle. So which one do you fancy?
Chocolate cherry cake.
Okay, I'm going to have lemon drizzle, that looks good. And what do you want to drink? They've got all sorts of soft drinks and coffees. Oh, they do specialty teas.
That'd be nice.
And also it says switch your mobile phones off as well. A little bit of peace and quiet. Are you listening? Excuse me, love, can we order, Chuck? I like these teacups and saucers. Do you think they'll miss them?
I think they might, actually.
Okay, listen, what do you want? Don't you fancy? You've got strawberry, got lemon, you've got cinnamon.
Cinnamon. Sounds nice. Cinnamon.
Do you fancy that?
Yeah.
Black Christmas, there you go, there's yours.
Thank you.
And put on the. Who was that lady with? Oh, thanks, Chuck. Oh, they look nice. Oh, I wish I'd had the chocolate one now.
Wow, look at those.
Yours is bigger than mine, it's not fair. Who was that lady we visited in Holland?
Tini van den Plas.
She kind of invented teabag folding, didn't she?
She did invent teabag folding, yes.
Tell you what, do you want to show us how to do it?
Yeah, okay, why not?
Have you got any scissors? You've got your toolbox with you?
I just so happen to have that, yes.
There you go. Barry is now going to show us how to make a teabag design. First, move your teacup.
And make sure that your design is flat.
Is that what you're doing? Flatten all the creases out?
It is.
So what are you going to do next?
And now I'm going to put a template over the top to make sure that I've got an accurate square.
Is that just a kind of a square and a bit of cardboard?
That's exactly what it is.
So why do you have to do that?
Well, because you've got to make sure that all of your pieces look the same. Otherwise, when you fold them, they won't be symmetrical.
Oh, now you're cutting it out.
Cutting it out. Make sure you cut it out accurately.
Now, I'm not daft. I can see that when you cut that out, you're going to get two pieces.
You are.
So you're going to cut down the middle.
I am.
But you're going to have two separate pieces, so they're not going to match up.
Nope, so you can use two different sets if you want to.
Oh, so you need eight of those, do you?
You need eight of those to make a rosette.
Oh, and that's your second set.
That's
clever.
Your second set. Clever, very
observant.
Oh, you're
not daft, you are, you know.
So the first thing we're going to do is the first fold.
Those nails look a bit suspect.
Oh, no, well, builder's hands.
Crafter's hands. Crafter's hands. So this is accuracy is really important.
It is. So I've done the first one corner to corner. Now I've turned it around. I'm going to do the second one corner to corner.
So if you start off with the white bit facing upwards,
precisely,
then just press it over. Oh, I see.
So make sure your folds are crisp. Now once you've got those first two folds, you do the second fold.
So you turn it over.
So you've got the pattern facing upwards.
And then you get the white back showing. So
exactly,
that's a good way to do it. So first of all, you had it the other way around with the design on the front.
So you turn it around again.
Yeah.
And then you fold it the opposite way.
Oh, accurately, of course.
Now, once you've done this, when you turn it over, it should naturally go into a triangle.
Oh, it looks like a pyramid. Naturally folds like that, doesn't
exactly
it? It's a triangle, yes, a little pyramid. So what do you do next?
Well, now we're going to fold the flaps across.
Oh, so that's like to an imaginary line down the middle.
That's right, imaginary line down the middle. And of course, this is going to make sure that this will all hold together properly as well.
That fold's looking a bit suspect.
Well, yeah.
Well, you're working back to front, aren't you?
I am.
Oh, look at that. Oh, but it's perfect now. The wonder of magic.
So now we're going to glue all of the rosettes together.
What are you using?
Glue.
Oh, ask a silly question, you get a silly answer. Was that a glue stick?
Any glue will do.
But you don't need too much on it. You don't want it oozing out all over,
no,
do you?
No, you don't.
So you're just tucking it in there and sticking it down.
Exactly.
So you've done a few here, have you?
That's right. And now we're going to finish it off. We just need to make sure we've got all eight together.
So what happens when you get to the end?
Well, you've got your rosette.
Ah, but then what about the last one?
The last one slides in there, and if you've got all the folds accurate, it should look perfect.
And it just tucks into the first one?
It just tucks into the first
Brilliant.
One.
Brilliant. You could have used a bit more glue there.
And you've got both sides there. Now you can choose which side you want.
Oh, I like the front side there.
Yeah, I do too.
Oh, have you got a little card pre-made?
I have prepared a card already.
Oh, you came prepared. Well done.
With some backing
points. Oh, you could have done a bit more glue on there. It's falling apart.
Oh yes, you can always tidy it up a little bit before you finish.
Well, you know, only tidying up, don't you?
Well, it was all under pressure. You know about pressure.
I'd have used a bit more glue on the back of that as well. It's going to fall off.
So let's just place that straight on.
Now, placing that on, you can put it so one point right to the top, or in your case, a little squiffy. That's a technical term.
Now, we've got some corners as well that we can use.
Oh, that's good. So it's exactly the same folds, but you're using them as corners.
Precisely.
I'll tell you what, those would be brilliant to use as corners on photographs for scrapbooking.
And they'd hold them in place too.
Absolutely fantastic. Hey, that's a lovely card. Oh, and have you got a little gallery here now,
yes,
as well, have you?
Yes.
Are these all different kind of different folds and different tea bags and that to get different effects?
Lots of different effects.
I tell you what, tea bags, Boston Tea Party, what was that all about?
That was all about the British taxing the Americans and not taxing themselves.
That wasn't very fair.
No.
So what kind of things did they tax?
Tea, wine, glass, paints, and paper.
But paper? Paints? I bet the crafters weren't very happy. I wouldn't have been very happy. I'd have revolted myself. In fact, I'm in Boston. Why don't I reenact the Boston Tea Party? Tell me more about it.
Well, a lot of very unhappy Americans, dressed no less as Mohawk Indians, turned up at Boston Harbour with the intentions of making a protest.
Oh, there must have been a fancy dress shop about.
Well, they boarded one of the ships packed with tea, broke open the tea chest and dumped the tea in the harbour.
So they didn't actually steal anything, they just threw it away.
Ruined it.
I could reenact that, I can do that, I can do that. Can I do it now?
Go on then.
And now I'm going to reenact the Boston Tea Party. Take that! So as we're still in Boston, what are we going to go and see now?
We're going to see Boston Stump. It's actually got the tallest tower in England. And it's actually called St. Botolph's.
Botox?
No, not Botox, Alan.
This is St. Botolph's Church in Boston, otherwise known as the Boston Stump, but locally, just the Stump. Now, this church is incredible. The tower took 70 years to build from 1450 to 1520. It's 272 feet and 6 inches tall, making it the tallest church in England. It also has strong links to the Pilgrim Fathers. Let's go and have a look inside. If you thought the outside of this church was impressive, the inside is magnificent. And there are also some very interesting facts about it as well. For instance, it's linked to the calendar and the clock. The church roof is supported by 12 pillars. It's illuminated by 52 windows, there are 7 doors, and there are 365 steps to the base of the tower. The links to the clock, there are 24 steps to the library, that's your hours, and the minutes and seconds, there are 60 steps to the top of the roof. This building is so rich with history and beauty.
Swelling his congregation with radical views, 17th century vicar John Cotton upset the church hierarchy. Moving to America in 1663, he was instrumental in naming Boston, USA.
I'm now sat in the beautiful John Cotton Chapel. Now, this chapel has had something of a checkered career. It used to, at one time, house the town fire engine. Then, in 1707, it became a school. And then, in 1857, it became the John Cotton Chapel. Now, I love this chapel. It is full of beautiful things, but I particularly love the exquisite altar.
So as we're still in Boston, what are we going to go and see now?
Oh, look! Just the thing, a windmill.
I wonder if it still makes flour. I can show them how to make salt dough.
The Maud Foster Mill was built in 1819 for the princely sum of £1,826.10/6. It took approximately 5 months to build. It was the last mill to be built in Boston out of 15, and it's the only one to survive. It worked continuously from 1819 until 1948, when it fell into disuse because of mechanical problems. But it was restored in 1988 and has been grinding flour in Boston ever since.
Now, it's very easy to make salt dough. All you need is a windmill. Well, you don't necessarily need a windmill. As long as you've got some flour, you need some salt. You need a bowl to mix it in. You also need a mug, water, and you also need flour as well. Now, to start off with, you need flour. Now, I'm sat next to where the flour actually comes into this big sack, but you can use it out of a bag, don't worry. Now, listen, all you need is 2 cups of that, level cups or mugs of that. See, there's one. Just pop it in the bowl, and 2. God, I wish I had one of these at home. Now, this is fantastic flour. 2 of those, and then you also need 1 of salt. Just ordinary salt, that's all you need. So it's 2 to 1. Anyway, so that's 2 to 1. And then all I'm going to do is mix that in like that together. So simple, you don't need anything else. Oh, this just feels fantastic. And then all you've got to do is dribble in some water like that, and then just mix it in. Start in the middle and just whisk it round with your fingers like that. Now, it doesn't matter if you wash your hands or not here, but it's a good advice if you do, because nobody's going to be eating this with all that salt in. So that's a bit dry. So I'm just going to add a little bit more water. Keep mixing it in. Now, you want a nice paste here, so it's really kind of easy to use, and it makes it almost like marzipan. But this seems like it's going to be perfect. Just mix it in. And now you can see this, I've got this into a nice ball of dough. So I'm going to take away the bowl, and I'm just, before I put this onto the board, I'm just going to sprinkle a little bit of flour on there like that, stop it sticking. And then what you've got to do is just knead this, just really knead it. Just putting your hand through it like that, rolling it over. Just keep doing that until it's lovely and smooth. And then what we'll do is put it to one side just to rest. So the salt dough is now nice and rested, so I can make my Harvest Festival loaf. First of all, roll it into a nice fat sausage and divide it into 3. You know, they've been celebrating harvest in every country, and every civilization has got some way of celebrating harvest, don't they? It could be fish from the sea, etc. This is a wheat harvest. So I've divided that into 3 and I've wrapped the 2/3 into polythene there to stop it getting a skin over the top, so it's nice to work with later on. Now, I've put a little bit of flour onto my work surface there, and I'm going to roll it out. Roll it out, think about making a pizza base. You just roll it nice and flat like that. Then you've got your template, cut that out, and put that over the top of your dough, and then cut that out.
Very clever. Do you know where the word harvest came from?
No, but you're going to tell me, aren't you?
The Anglo-Saxon Harefest, meaning autumn.
Autumn, oh, fabulous. Now, I've cut that out now, and what I'm going to do is put a rolling pin on and just roll it up.
And there was another festival before that, yeah, called Lammas, meaning loaf mass.
Loaf mass, so it's Harvest Festival Loaf Mass. Mm. Oh, fantastic. Now, I've put this onto a baking sheet there, and then I can do the next bit, which is this. Nice long sausage, bit more dough, and then cut that into little chipolatas. and then roll these nice and thin. They almost look like mice's tails or long, long fiddly worms there. And they're going to be the stalks on the harvest loaf.
Now, the modern harvest festival, the one as we know it, started in 1843. With a Cornish vicar called Robert Harker, who invited all of his parishioners round to celebrate and give thanks for the harvest.
Oh, he was nice, wasn't he?
Yeah.
He had a bit of a party, and he did. Pulled that spread from this. Brilliant. Now listen, you see what I'm doing here? I'm sticking the stalks on. First of all, I actually brushed it with some water, and then just put the stalks on, nice and thin, and then just layer them up so you get a nice, nice bunch of stalks there, and just trim it with a knife. Now I'm going to make the harvest festival loaf. The heads of the wheat corn there.
Ooh.
Now roll it out again into a nice big rope sausage there and divide it into little pieces. Try and get every piece more or less the same size, then that helps the look of the whole thing when you've finished it. Roll it into a ball first and then roll it into a nice thin sausage like that. And then take the edge of your hand and just roll down one side to get a nice pointed look.
Now the Americans have a very special Thanksgiving, in fact it's called Thanksgiving, which they celebrate on the 4th Thursday of every November.
Do they? Oh, tell me more about that. I've got an interesting bit coming up here. Look, you can just cut it one side using scissors of the wheat sheaf head there, so you're forming like the little husks. Is that what they're called? Husks?
That's right.
Oh, so I've done one side and now do exactly the same on the other. Even you could do this, couldn't you?
Mm-hmm.
Simple, anybody can do it. And then we're going to cut down the centre just like that.
Now, the first Thanksgiving in America was celebrated in 1621.
Was it?
Yep.
Now listen, I'm going to stick those heads on there now, but before you do, just go around with some water again. It's important putting your water on there because otherwise they won't stick together and it'll just all disintegrate once you've actually kind of baked it. So start off with your first one, nice and neat in the middle, and we're going to go all the way around, just making more heads as you go and just adding to the design.
And it was enshrined as a public holiday during the tenure of Abraham Lincoln.
What? Thanksgiving was?
It was.
Oh! I wish I had Thanksgiving in this country as well. It'd be like having two Christmases, wouldn't it?
I think you can just about cope with one.
Oh, really? Can you see how this is building up? See, anybody can do this. All, you just automatically come together. All you've just got to do is put one next to each other and just go round. Now, you're left with a ball bit in the middle. Do you see that ball bit in the middle there?
I did. What are you getting
now, listen, you've got a ball bit as well, but you can't cure it this way.
Hmm.
Take another one of those wheat sheaf heads there and start in the middle. That's important. And cut one side and then the opposite side and then down the middle. And then guess what you've got to do?
Go on.
Turn it round. Turn it round, yes, and do exactly the same the opposite way. Then it looks like you've got two wheat sheaf heads there stuck together. And then you just gently put that in the middle of the bowl bit there and just gently press it down. And you've finished. Voila! Your wheat sheaf. Fantastic. Now, guess what I'm going to make you?
Go on.
I've got a little bit of dough here. I'm going to make the Harvest Festival mouse that goes on the loaf. First, take a little bit and just roll it into a long, thin strip to be the tail. Make it nice and pointed on the end. A little bit of water on the loaf, and then just twiggle it onto the loaf there, ready to put the body on. Now, that's another ball of dough there, and then just roll down one side so you form like a pear shape, really, a bit of a pear, so it's got a nice big fat bum there at the back. And then what we can do is put some eyes on. Now, to make the eyes, I've just got some cloves there. So just push those in either side. And you can see the mouse is coming together just by doing that.
Very nice.
I'm going to give it some ears. Give it some ears. I'm going to use the scissors there, just like I did with the wheat sheaf heads there. Just cut either side, and you've got the ears to the mouse.
Aww.
Then just stick that onto the bottom there of the wheat sheaf, and you've got the traditional Harvest Festival loaf finished there. Don't that look fantastic?
It does.
Now, listen, we're going to bake this. Now, traditionally, salt dough should be baked very, 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 very slowly in a very low oven or left to dry. But I want it to look like bread. So I'm actually brushing it with some beaten egg here, and then that'll give it a nice shine. So I'm going to pop it into a nice hot oven and then just flash that for about 5 minutes till it's brown, then turn it off and leave it in overnight. So it's been in there about 8 hours now and it's completely dry, but then put it on a wire rack there so it can carry on drying. Any moisture in there will come out, and there you've got one. A little bit of a decorative wheat sheaf there. You can hang it on your walls or do what you like with it. Now this one's a little bit shiny. A little bit shiny. Yes, I know I burnt this one, you can see. But give it 3 coats of varnish, but not the back, because if there's any moisture in there, you want it to evaporate, and then you've got the perfect decorative wheat sheaf. Well, that was a good day, wasn't it?
Yes, I enjoyed Boston.
Where do you want to go now, Betty?
New York.
New York?
Next time, we'll be visiting Wharton in Lancashire.
Yes, and it's got a great connection with America.
In fact, George Washington's family came from here.
The village and church are beautiful, and we're going to get very creative here too.
And you can even see a shield on the inside of the church that comprises three stars and stripes.
And it's said that it may be where the original idea for the stars and stripes came from.
And we'll be meeting lots of very creative people. In fact, we'll make a fantastic 3D picture inspired by this wonderful, wonderful tapestry. And we'll even get to make some tassels as well. And it's all on the next show.
Oh, I've always wanted to go to Broadway, boys. Here we are, the glam, the lights, the shows. What? This is not the New York I thought it was. You promised me New York. The real New York.
Well, perhaps another time, eh, Betty?